this book.
I think in 1994, some 25 years ago, I came to Kathmandu, and within a legislative committee, I was a legislator for 2 terms. I was MLC member of the upper house of Karnataka state. So I came with the legislative committee. At that time in 1994, I wandered some places, streets, common people areas, like that. I was not interested in temples, going to temples. I was interested to see the people and talk to the poor people, common people. And they were, some people said, spoke in favor of Communist Party, emerging Communist Party at that time. As hotel workers, hotel suppliers, they were all talking about pro-communist things. So I thought one day the communism will capture the power of this country. I guess 25, 30 years ago. Because ordinary people were speaking in favor of communism. Of course, after communism came here, I don't know what happened. Were they benefited? Were they not with the poor people? Expectation were realized. I don't know anything about this. But 30, 25 years ago, I smelt the emerging of the communism here. Because ordinary people were all in favor of communism. A small boy also, a small boy was praising communism. So after 25 years, I don't know what happened. Communism, of course, communist rule has come. I don't know, was it benefited the poor people, changed the structure of the society, eradicated the poverty. I don't know anything about that. Now by that time I came as a legislator of Karnataka, a member of the upper house, MLC. But today I came as a writer. I was twice MLC, 2 times I was MLC, and I was holding after that I was holding Kannada Development Authority chairman post. It is equal to cabinet rank position. After that, I was holding Kannada Book Authority chairman post. It was also holding state minister rank post. For 20 years, I was in power. But power means I fought for the Dalits. Especially Dalits of Karnataka, and I was sympathizer of Marxism since my student days. So I was sympathizing. I fought for the cause of the farmers, workers, poor people, the street vendors, vegetable vendors, especially the ladies who were beaten up by the police for the clearance of the widening of the road or clearing the road, and scavengers and fire workers, fire force staff who will fight against fire, in the state. So many departments, whoever gets salary, less salary, 2,000 rupees, 5,000 rupees, like that. And whoever humiliated in their workplace, and who are facing the untouchability problem, casteism, no entry to temple, no entry to this thing, groups which are for religious groups, and no entry to the hotels, public places, those who are denied the permission to enter the public places, they are called untouchables in our country. I fought for them because I come from that community, untouchable community. I experienced these things in my childhood itself. So when I become legislator, for 12 years I fought tooth and nail against this system. Because of my struggle, government made new acts itself to eradicate this curse, and to help the Dalits. The Dalits means untouchables. In a way, I did good thing, I think so. And two volumes have come, my major speeches in the council, to one renowned film journalist called Rukoji Rao. He was not a Dalit, he is not a Dalit, but he's a progressive person. He's a progressive person who my thing is, I not only fought for the Dalits, worked for the Dalits, the non-Dalits who are suffering from poverty, unemployment, harassment, though they may be upper caste fellows, but they are suffering the curse of poverty, unemployment. So I fought for those. To see much changes, I don't see much change. So much of change I don't see. I want to see, because yesterday night I came, but when I on the way itself I didn't change. But I saw one thing, one change. Big buildings are there, five-story buildings, six-stories buildings, big buildings. At that time there was no such buildings. I think more buildings must be there. Because of that earthquake, some buildings collapsed. Very unfortunate thing, earthquake. Because I wrote a long poem about the earthquake of Nepal. It published in famous daily in Karnataka, Prajavani.
Punjabi, yeah.
It is very famous, top leading,
Yeah.
senior most paper in
Karnataka.
surviving
Yeah.
Karnataka.
Yeah, okay.
Since decades, it is being published. That paper published this poem. I wrote a long poem about the earthquake and disasters of Nepal at that time.
Okay.
I forget to, but I can bring, ask them to send the poem in Kannada, but I would like to translate, get it translated, and I will send to you that poem. And also for another reason, not for earthquake reason, I like Nepal. I feel sad about that earthquake and these natural calamities. But because of Buddha, I like Nepal very much. Always I was thinking to come to Nepal again, because next time I will certainly have to come and go to Lumbini,
Lumbini.
Kapilavastu, because nowadays, being a Marxist for so many decades, now I am 65. Nowadays I am interested in Buddhism. Buddhism and Marxism, I feel no difference. Excluding minus violence, there is no such great difference between Marxism and Buddhism. Ambedkar told this. Ambedkar has written about, Ambedkar has written a book called Marxism and Buddhism. He compared Buddha and Marx. He says there is no difference between minus two, three concepts. One is violence, second is proletarian dictatorship. He didn't believe that. He saw one day proletariat may become a dictator and party may come as a dictator. It may not help the working class. So but I believe till to today, I believe fundamentals of Marxism, concern to the poor, concern to the working class, poor people, downtrodden people, those who are exploited. I am for them. Till today, I am writing, I am speaking for them, and I fought in the legislature also. Fundamentals of Marxism, a scientific analysis of the structure of the society, I like very much, but not dogmatism. Dogmatic Marxism, I don't like. And also, unfortunately, Marxist of our country, India, for decades, they denied the reality. They didn't understand the reality of the real structure, ground reality of the Indian society. They stood for class struggle. Actually, they did not accept the existence of the caste system, existence of the untouchability, exploitation in the name of religion and God. They concentrated on only wages, only bonus, and fighting for working class. That is, it doesn't, it didn't help them. That's the problem. Yes, certainly, but it is not the fault of the Marx. The fault of the people who applied Marxism to the situation. They didn't understand the situation, local situation. Because in Russia, Lenin applied it in a different way. Mao applied the Marxism in a different way. And he preferred the farmers. Farmers. But in Russia, it didn't happen. But in India, we should have gone both, they should have blended the caste and class struggle. It didn't happen. Yes. One Ambedkar wrote a book called Annihilation of Caste. He was supposed to give a lecture in a conference. When he was president over that conference, Jagpat Todak Patil conference in Punjab, when he sent the script to the organizers, they didn't approve his presidential address. So he published that book without delivering the talk. That is the annihilation of caste. So in that book, he explained how caste must be eradicated. But we want to come manifesto of the Communist Party. We want both manifesto of the Communist Party of 1848 by Marx and Engels. Manifesto of the Communist Party, 1888, and in 1936, Ambedkar speech, Annihilation of Caste. That it has come in book form also. We want both things.
Okay.
I don't think so. I think caste system must be here also. I think people who are staying here must say, I think so, because it is Hindu nation, Hindu culture. Naturally, Hindu culture carries caste system with it.
Yeah.
So, caste system must be there here. I am not saying it must be there. I am saying it may be there. And untouchability also may be there. Some untouchable caste must be there in Nepal. It should be recognized, it should be eradicated, the untouchability system, caste hierarchy must be eradicated. Of course, as a legislator, I took the cause of this downtrodden people to the legislature and I fought against it. Some acts were made, at least. It can be done if sincerely, if a legislator is fight and is particular about solving this problem. Certainly something will happen. So that happened in my case. Certainly, because one lota dirbekala. Thank you, Ramesh. Certainly, I didn't forget my community and the problem facing by my community when I become the legislator. I was alert for 2 years. I was alert and I tried to get the attention of the government to this kind of so many problems. If a Dalit lady, though she is an officer, in a temple feast, in a temple, all were contributed for that temple ritual and feast. They were all eating together. Simply, then suddenly, this lady also, one in that the group, one Dalit lady officer was there. In that group, suddenly some priest come and drag out that lady from the dining hall. They pushed away from the dining hall. She was given the contribution. She was an officer, she was an educated, she was an office, good officer, and also she was working in the same office or same group with the group. And in the, when they are eating together, taking prasadam, eating together, people come and they drag it, they catch hold of that lady. And they dragged away and they pushed out of the temple. It happened in so many times for so many people because they belong to a particular community. So it is happening. I raised these kind of things, so many incidents. They were arrested. Those priests were put under, put behind the bar, at least for some days. They might have realized what is truth, what is truth and what is not truth. Certainly, certainly. A feeling of a sense of feeling, a sense, a kind of new awareness, new sense, a kind of new thing emerged me, came to me after realizing this kind of discrimination in the society. So I, when I, in my early days, even in my school days itself, I joined the movement which is organized to change this kind of system. This is a system of exploitation, system based on hierarchy, system with caste and class, full of contradictions. I joined the movement with the student days itself. So till today, methods may be changed. Methods from that day to this day may be changed. But I didn't leave my fundamental belief in humanity, equality, fraternity, and all of the, everyone is equal. This philosophy, till today I follow, I fight for that. But not in a, not as aggressive as my childhood days, my younger days. But I stick on to the philosophy of equality, humanity. I like that because I myself was a victim of this system. My parents were victims of this system. My mother was a sweeper. When I became a poet, when I, in my post-graduation, when I was studying my post-graduation degree.
In which subject?
In Kannada literature. I became a Kannada poet. My first public anthology of poetry, Nagesh knows, Hole Madigara Hadu, Song of Untouchables. Holiyas and Madigas, these are abusing words actually.
Two castes, two untouchable castes.
Two untouchable
castes. Like here, Gandharvas, and others, so me, so two, three castes, among untouchables.
Those Holiyas.
Say, Holiya is one caste.
And those are abusive names.
Discrimination. And his title of the poetry collection is Vale Madigara Hadu. It's a song of Valayas and Madigas who are untouchable.
I accept that abusing words. I put the abusing names itself to my poetry. Vale Madigara Hadu. That means Sang of Valiyas and Madigas. If a person say in publicly Valiya, will be arrested. Hey Madiga, it is abusive word. You'll be arrested.
Under Indian Constitution.
It is abusive. But I was bold enough to take those two names. Happily, I am a Valiya. I am a Madiga. These are my songs. These are the songs of Aliyas and Madigas. Song of Untouchables. When I joined the movement, I started writing poetry in 13, 14 years. Why? I was in a graveyard for some time because I was living in a slum area, in a hut, a small 10 by 10 hut. There was not so much of accommodation to, if somebody gets come to stay there, gets come to sit and talk to my mother or father. Have to always have to go out and stand in front of my house, in front of my heart. But one day I decided I should not stand like this. I should go straight. Let us find out a dead end and come back. I went straight away. In the dead end, I found a big graveyard. Graveyard, Smashana. And I saw the graveyard, I was so happy to see that. I was so happy, it was bigger than my house. 100 times bigger than my house. Big trees and benches, stone benches to sit. And in the evening, the electric lights were there in the graveyard. And flower, good flowers were there. I was attracted by that graveyard. And I went and sat there. I started going daily, sitting there, reading there, writing there, till 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. And they started serving tea also. The people who cremate there, cremation work, doing cremation work.
Dead bodies.
Dead bodies. They became my close friends. They started serving food and tea, chai, and for some days, I was teaching to their children also in the night. So my poetry became very strong because I wrote it in a graveyard. It has graveyard symbols. It has graveyard metaphors. Because I was so young, I described graveyard as a beautiful girl. I say to graveyard, you are a beautiful lady girl. I love you very much. You are my life.
Beloved.
You are my
beloved
poetry. So these kind of romantic things happened to me.
Okay. So how far from your home?
1 kilometer.
1 kilometer, okay.
Not even 1 kilometer. One kilometer, I can say.
Could you mention that name of place? Like Girappuram.
Srirampuram.
Srirampuram.
Harichandra Ghat.
Harisandra?
Harishchandra.
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 The fortunate thing is, though I wrote this poetry in a graveyard, I was dreaming that the people who were cremated, those bodies under the earth, skeletons,
bones, yeah,
must become again, they should become
take life.
They should take life and they should become person as early before that day, as before that day. They should go in the rally against the exploitation. Because of the exploitation, humiliation, they died. They should take a rebirth.
Yeah.
And they should go in the rally singing my songs, these dead bodies. It was my dream and I wrote those things.
Like Holiya song.
Yeah. And actually, when I joined the workers, peasants, Dalits movement in the state, these songs became the basic inspiration for their struggle. Everywhere they started singing my songs. I was so happy. All part of Karnataka. The people used to sing my song. Even not only the untouchables, the workers of all castes, the peasants of all castes. Because Ambedkarism awakened me, Marxism educated me. Because of Ambedkar thoughts, Ambedkar influence, I realized the problems of untouchables, pain of untouchables, suffering of these people. But when I came in touch with Marxism, I realized the suffering people are there in all the communities, not only Dalits, not only in India, not only all over the world.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The people were suffering with hunger, pain, exploitation. They are all over the world. So they are my people. So I belong to them. Those who are the suffering. I wanted to identify myself with the suffering humanity of the world. The Marxism taught me this. This fundamental truth, fundamental thing. So I am grateful to both Ambedkar and Marx. They doubted me, the revered people, earlier. He may be informant to the police. He is a dangerous fellow. We should throw out of graveyard, throw out from the graveyard. They were planning me. They were planning. But by that time, I had become a public speaker about in Ambedkar birthday celebrations in that area. Somebody who saw me when I was giving public speech in Ambedkar birthday celebration, he will be Dalit. Naturally, graveyard people also Dalits.
Most of.
He came there, came to meet their friends. They told him that the one dangerous fellow is coming, what to do? We'll throw him out like that. That fellow told them, he's very, very important person, learned person. He give wonderful speeches in public. He's a leader like that. In an exaggerated way, he introduced me to them. From that day onwards, these people started serving tea to me, biscuit to me. There is a bond of friendship, emotional bond. Till today, I am having that bond. Till today, I used to go there, not regularly. Often I will go and inquire about their health. I have a tea there, I will come back. My first public speech was delivered successfully in public in 1968, April 14th. It was the Ambedkar birthday. Ambedkar's birthday. From that day onwards, people inviting me to speak here, there, that place, this place, all over Karnataka. I am going now also. Karnataka, Kannada language. The language of Karnataka is Kannada.
Kannada,
Kannada language got 8 Jnanapeetha awards in Parvati Hindi. Parvati national language. Highest Jnanapeetha award won by given to Karnataka writers. Sometimes we challenged India also.
Okay.
And it is the oldest language. Oldest 5,000 years history is there.
It is older than Hindi. Older than Hindi. So, Kannada writers are very famous all over the world.
Kannada films are known for awards in art films, offbeat films, artistic films.
Very leading.
Leading, yeah.
Leading.
Malayalam of Kerala state and Kannada of Karnataka, Bengali are the three states. Films are the leading always ahead.
I stand for humanity. I stand for humanity, and humanity is higher than any ideology, higher than any dogmatic ideology. Ideology must be human essence, human centered, human welfare, for human existence. We should allow him to exist as a human being, not as an animal. Not as a victim. So I prefer the humanity now.
Okay.
Though with all respect to Ambedkar and Marx, I put humanity in higher place because both of them fought for humanity. But those people in the name of Ambedkar, in the name of Marxism, in the name of other Gandhi, even Gandhi, other great people, people are indulging in creating violence and misleading the people
No.
and amassing the money, becoming corrupt. It is not. It is insult to the great people. Oh, I've come as a poet. 25 years ago, I come as a legislator.
Yeah.
Today, I come as a poet. But first glimpses I saw, big buildings are very big than the 25 years ago. Buildings are very big. I don't know the fate of the poor people here. I want to go around Kathmandu and other places. But normally the Nepalese are very good people. Soft. Soft, very soft spoken. And they don't cheat. It is the image we have in India about the Nepalese. They are dependable. One can believe them. They are not cheaters. They are hard workers. A kind of humility, humbleness, goodness is there in their faces. I like that.
Do you have any?
And Nepali smile also good. Maybe male or female. The smile is innocent smile.
Do you have any poem about Nepali?
I wrote a poem when earthquake happened in Nepal some years ago, some 3 4 years ago, when a big earthquake happened. I wrote a lengthy poem about this earthquake and about the disaster with the solidarity. In that poem, there is a solidarity with the Nepali people. Even their suffering, with their suffering, we are solidarity. I published it in Prajavani, a leading daily in Canada. Next, I will send you the English version of it. I am interested in Nepali folklore because I am a folklorist basically. I am a folklorist and I am interested in Nepali culture, rituals and gods and goddesses and the possession cult, occult in the interior places, tantric cult, these kind of cults. Because my doctoral thesis was village goddesses of Karnataka. I am an expert in village goddesses of Karnataka. So I am interested to know about the goddesses of Nepal, gods and goddesses of Nepal.